Why?
It's one of my. Oh.
All right, good morning, Tri-County. This is a beautiful morning out there. Smell the fresh mulch walking in. Appreciate everyone's hard work yesterday. I heard it was a good crowd. All right, if everyone would come in, we're going to get started. This morning, I'm going to share a verse to start us out. Before I get there, I'm going to go to a shameless plug, if I can. So our mission trip is planned for July 4th. There's about 12 of us going. We have a fundraiser coming up. It's going to be Loco Lucas's famous fajitas. Yay, I'm advertising for that. So it's going to be May 21st. That's a Saturday night from 5 to 7. We'll have fajitas over there. Fajitas, it's going to be chicken fajitas with pico de gallo, black beans, rice, guacamole. We're also going to make like chicken nuggets and vegetable and applesauce for kidlets. So you can bring your family. You can grab it and go, or you can grab it and stay. We'll set up some tables, maybe play some board games. I know somebody wants to play chess. I don't know who would want to play chess. Yeah. So it'll be a time of fellowship if you want to stay in fellowship or if you just want to come and grab some food. But we appreciate it if you'd spread the word, let people know. What we're asking for is a minimum donation of $10 per person or $30 per family. So if you have a large family like mine, it's a deal. Come in, get some chicken fajitas, some chicken nuggets for the kids. So that's a shameless plug, all right? I want to read a verse this morning to help kick us off this Sunday. I'm going to read out of Isaiah chapter 21, verse 11 and 12. It says, he calls to me out of Seir, watchman, what of the night? Watchman, what of the night? The watchman said, the morning comes and also the night. If you will inquire, inquire, return, come back. He says, watchman, watchman, what of the night? And when I read that, I feel some stirring, some fear is what I hear. Watchman, watchman, what about the night? I think in our society today, we hear the same cry. We think about Ukraine. We say, what's going on? It's so bad. What about the night? We go to the grocery store and bread went up 200%. And we say, watchman, what about the night? When is this going to end? It's getting so bad. But we hear about all of the different things and maybe even private things in our own lives. And we say, what about the night? What about the night? First, I want to say that a true watchman has a good answer. And the answer from the true watchman is, the day is coming. Hallelujah. The day is coming. Oh, we're worried about the night. We're worried about all of the things that are going wrong. We're worried about all the sadness and all the heartache and all of this. But the watchman who's got the true word of God says the day is coming. The day is coming. Jesus is the light. Jesus is the day. He's the bright and morning star. And he's the one. The watchman says, yes, there's the night. No doubt about it, there's the night. The scripture is placed in a series of hard prophecies. No doubt about it, there's the night. But I want to encourage us as a church, when we're going to find answers, if the person who's speaking to us is only telling us about what's wrong, that's probably not the person we need to listen to. We got to hear about Jesus. Any message that's coming at you that's not telling you about salvation, that's not telling you about the light, that's not telling you about the hope that we have, this is not really a word from the Lord. The watchman will tell you about Jesus. Oh, he's not going to deny that there's night. He's not going to deny that there's hard times. He's not going to deny it. He might even be able to help you to understand it. But the foundation of what the watchman is going to say is Jesus. The light, the morning comes. Amen.
Well, welcome, Tri-County. How is everyone today? Yeah, great. Excellent. Wonderful. He is risen. Yeah, that was good. We'll work on that. I like saying that. That's a fun one. Welcome to Tri-County, everyone, those here and those watching online. Nice to see you all. We're still doing offerings in the back. We'll probably keep and maintain that. You can drop your offerings off throughout the service at the end, preferably. And those who want to give online as well, you can give through Tri-County Worship Center /give. We mentioned life groups that we have going on most days of the week, Sundays, Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Fridays, and Saturdays. Now, we do a bit more of a corporate thing on Monday evenings. That's for the whole church. That's a prayer night. So that starts at 7 p.m. I want to mention that one. Again, Sunday school. We have at 9 o'clock in the morning before service starts at 10:15, so you're always welcome to that. And we always mention family night. Family night is one that we do on Wednesdays. That starts at 7 p.m. We have things for men. We have things for women. We have another adult class for men and women, which is #hope, overcoming dependency behaviors together. And we have things for kids of all ages. And the aim is really to be a church who's growing in the knowledge of God, learning the word of God, engaging and fellowshipping with the people of God, and enjoying each other. So it's a wonderful time. Come out on Wednesdays. We have a parent meeting after church today for all of the kids planning on going to kids camp, God's Story. All 4 weeks, week one and two, July 11th through the 15th is the week that we will be going specifically. It will be with Aaron Gruber. The Bongiorno Conference Center, Carlisle, PA. And that'll be with a meeting with Aaron right outside. Which room is it in, Aaron? In Aaron's office, which is the second door on your left. So come into that room for all the parents. We have a short meeting. We really don't want to hold you up. So Aaron tries to make things very lickety-split. So please just come out. And ladies and girls, it's a tea time. Let's honor mothers, Wednesday, May 4th at 7 p.m. Invite family and friends to attend with you for some tea. We have the Turbo Kids will be dismissed during the sermon time. And I have two other things that aren't mentioned on us for slides. One is, again, we're still trying to reiterate about coffee, drinks, food in the sanctuary. Wayne was in here vacuuming and trying to clean up some things on the carpet and found quite a few coffee stains. So we really just want to try to keep and maintain the integrity and just the carpet and not have to replace it. It's quite expensive. So that, stay with your parents, both on with your kids. Don't let them running around both on Wednesday nights as well as on Sundays. You know, have them walk them to the bathroom. It's just as far as a security thing. And the other thing I want to mention is Steve Snyder's father, Dennis. Maybe some of you know him particularly. It was 3 weeks ago. He fell, broke his hip. He spent the last 20-some days in the hospital. Not doing well. If you know Steve, Steve's a single father. He's getting ready to be married this summer. But till then, he's going to be working. He needs people to help with his dad. His dad needs 24/7 care. So if you have availability to drop a meal off, spend some time while no one's there and it's just him, he really should not be alone. I spoke with him. I was there on Friday. And he's wonderful, high spirits. He might repeat the same thing to you, but he is wonderful company to just spend time with. So if you're interested and you have it on your heart, please help out. For a couple weeks, and still we can start getting some other programs from the government to start helping out and accommodating that area of help. So if that would be the case, please see me if you have any questions or you would be available for a meal or things like that. If everybody would stand together and just raise your hand. I want everybody to just raise your hand. Lord, we come before you, God. Lord, so, so grateful, filled with joy, filled with awe, filled with wonder at your majesty, at your power, at your influence, at your love, at your goodness, at your holiness, God. You are wonderful in so many ways, Lord. And God, we've gathered together to give you praise, to lift you up, to magnify you, to give you our problems and concerns, to have it replaced with your peace, God. Lord, you've promised me that we'd be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer and petition, presenting our requests to you, God, and your peace will guard our hearts and our minds. God, I pray now, Lord, that you would start removing burdens in this place. God, would you start lifting people's hearts and minds towards you to focus on the greatest good, the greatest lover, the greatest friend, the greatest treasure that you are. God, that you would just explode in our hearts with a joy and that we can adore you and lift you up and magnify you in this praise service. God, we give you praise with the loud voice, the church together. We say thank you, God. Yes, God, we thank you. We come into your presence. We worship you. We love you. In Jesus' name.
Welcome to Sunday morning. Are we ready to worship today? Are we ready to worship? Here we go. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade, are never enough. Put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you see them all. You still call me friend. The God of the mountain is still God of the valley. And there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's dancing. You keep beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You turn beauty from ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who cares. You turn grace into God. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who cares. You're the only one who glory. You're the only one who cares. Only one who cares. You're the only one who
sing. Hosanna. We sing hallelujah.
wonderful, God-honoring, Christ-focused worship. I'm just hearing the Lord, though, saying for today's altar call, though, just about intercession, just to bring someone with you to this altar today, someone that you want to pray for, someone you want to bless, someone you want to cover, and then get covered by. Bring someone to the altar today. This is the call to know that our God hears us, to know that our God doesn't just hear us, but He moves at the prayers of His people. God is a wonderful, awesome God. So when we sing this next song, leave your seats, bring someone with you, come to the altar and intercede. Lift your voices to the King who can hear, who can answer, and who can move mountains.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Overcome. Oh, the Lamb is overcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, God is here. God is here. And He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you right here to come and release all those burdens, all the broken dreams, the tears, the heartache can be left at the foot of the cross, that the blood of Jesus Christ can wash it away, that you'd be restored. The blood of Christ laying upon your life destroys darkness and sin. It restores you to health and life again. Come. He's waiting.
Father, we come before you, God. Lord, you're moving right now. We're not going to rush out of this moment, God. Lord, deliver and heal. Touch hearts and minds, God. Thank you for your tangible presence today, God. Lord, we adore you. We need you. God, help. Help today. God, show up, God. I say it to my wife often, God, just take the show, God. We don't want to play church, God. We want to be the church. Lord, we want you to show up. We want you to minister. We want you to heal and save and touch lives, God. This is meaningless, God, if you're not part of it. We love you, Lord. We love you. Can you lift your voice? Can you praise Him today? You're worthy, God. We lift you up, God. Over our situations, we lift you higher. I know what I'm going through, but I know what you went through, Christ. Thank you, Lord, for going to the cross for me.
Hallelujah.
Lift Him up, church.
Worthy. Worthy.
You're holy, you are loving, you are kind, you are gracious. Lift Him up, church. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, God. We're going to clap. As Pastor says, let's clap all the way for the Lord. You know what? God's not done here today. I believe providentially, I've been walking through the book of Philippians, and today, this specific passage is for right now. Do you believe God's word is alive? Do you believe it wants to touch your heart and minister to your needs and encourage you and direct you? It's going to. It's going to, because we serve a big God, church. We have a quick video to share. That we're going to do as you're just shaking hands, wiping tears and snot off your faces. So if you would just watch the screen here. If the video, is it going to work or... We save it? Is the video working? Oh, it's not working? Thank you, Vince. All right, well, we're going to scratch that. We'll just, is it good? No, just go on without it, I hear. Proceed. All right, that sounds good. So, yeah. God is so wonderful, church. He is so wonderful. There was a young man, a young pastor, who was having to lead out a funeral. And after the actual celebratory aspect, they were going to the grave. And the funeral procession started where he was leading all of the individuals behind him. And while he's going, he really... Oh, did they get it going? All right. Yes, thank you. That Easter egg hunt was absolutely phenomenal.
tremendous amount of just outreach and people from the community that came out and just enjoying a wonderful time of family fun and hearing Christ preached, hearing the gospel. It was altogether really wonderful. So thank you for everyone who made that possible and who was there for it. It was absolutely fantastic. All the volunteers, thank you, thank you, thank you. Those who were here yesterday for the work day, thank you, thank you, thank you. We have a church that really serves, and I'm grateful for it. So it's yes, yes. Clap for you all. Right. Okay, so we're back to this story. Okay. So this young man, this young pastor, he's actually having to do a funeral. It's a you know, it's not the best situation, but he's having to do a funeral, and he's leading the procession as they're heading their way to the grave. And, you know, it's the pastor first, then it's, you know, those in the cask, in the, what is that called, when the ball bearers are in there, and then all the procession of all the other vehicles, and he's this long line. Well, while he's driving, he can't hold it anymore. He's really has to go pee. He has to go to the bathroom so bad. He just cannot hold it, and he's looking, where am I going to go? What am I going to do? There's all these people following me. He finally pulls up to this old abandoned building that he finds that there was an outhouse he saw he was driving past. So he goes in, and it wasn't just number one. It happened to be number two, and he's like, oh, I'll just catch up to everybody else. It'll be no problem. Meanwhile, he comes out, and all the cars have pulled in staring at him. How uncomfortable would that have been? The whole point to his story is that there's going to be many people that will lead us. But there's going to be people that lead us. Are they leading us towards Christ, or are they leading us to an outhouse? And today's message, I'm going to be mentioning about examples. And it's an example to follow, an example to be, and an example to flee. We've been walking through the book of Philippians, and I've had the pleasure of going line by line, verse by verse, and now we're almost three quarters of the way through Philippians. And up to this point, we can be reminded that Paul is sitting in prison, chained to two Roman guards, in prison for his faith and sharing the gospel. And even though he's not sure the way this court hearing is going to go, that he might be beheaded because of sharing Christ and what's happened, he constantly mentions joy. Philippians is a book of joy, that despite his circumstances, people are hearing the word of God. The praetorium guard, the specialty prison guards, they're hearing the word. There's people outside the church defaming Paul, insulting Paul. But he says, you know what? What does it matter to me if Christ is preached, whether from good motives or from negative motives? His focus, his heart, his aim, his direction was Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. One of my favorite verses in chapter 1, he says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. His focus, his intention, his heart, Paul was all about the Lord. And as he's talking to the Philippian church, there's a couple things he has to get right. They have to get right or work on or aim towards. Chapter 2, he's mentioning about unity. He's talking to them about having the same mind, preferring others in love, being joined together, collectively following Christ. And we come to chapter 3 where he points out those who would be against the cross, those who would be an obstacle, those who would be in the way, these Judaizers, these legalists who would try to add to the work of Christ by saying you must be circumcised and you must follow the law of Moses to be able to have forgiveness of sin, to have justification. And he goes into great lengths how he's done it better. He's done it better. They think they've got it good. No, I've been there, done that to a higher degree than you. And you know what? It's bankrupt. I exchanged all things, he says. I would give up all things for the sake of knowing Christ. Christ is now his treasure, his reward, his joy, his pleasure. It's about Jesus. So we pick up this passage today after we last time mentioning in verses 12 through 16 in chapter 3, how he says that not that I've already been made perfect, but I press on. to grab hold of that for which Christ Jesus grabbed hold of me. I focus, I forget what lies behind. One thing I do, I forget what's behind. I press on, I strain forward to reach the goal, the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ. He's going to say, my intention, my motivation, my growth process is towards God, and I'm not looking anywhere else. He's got that tunnel vision. So he comes to this point where now in Philippians 3, in verse 17, we'll read our verses for today. We'll only get through 17 through 19. And if you would follow along, it says, brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. For many walk, of whom I have often told you and now tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their minds on earthly things. I had actually planned on going through the end of chapter 3, but found it so important with these verses to take a little extra time to savor it, to really chew the cud. And that's an expression for savoring and meditating on God's word. So I pray that you would give diligence to listening, to hearing, and to responding to what these words and the insights from God's word says today. The first verse it's mentioning here, he says in 17, he says, brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according. When he says, brethren, join in following, he's talking about unity. He doesn't want outliers in the church at Philippi, that some are have a mission of Christ and others have their own mission. Others have their own agenda. They have their own ministries that aren't related to, affected by, in the same resolve with the church at large. He wants them together to do something, and that something is to follow his example. Now, at first, it might sound as though he's pretty egotistical. Paul's saying, hey, after just getting done saying, I'm not perfect, he now says, follow me, though. But really, it's because his heart and his life is so tied to Christ that he is sold out, abandoned, all in. There's no choice for him than other to follow Jesus with everything that's in him. That's his heart and his main motivation. So when he says to follow my example, he says it in many other passages, and even in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, follow me as I follow Christ. I wish all of you were as I am, except for these chains. On many occasions, he constantly encourages people to follow his example. Why? Because we need to know how to walk, how to live, how to do this thing called being a Christian. Examples are so important in culture. You see, for example, how even adolescents, young men and women without parental figures, one of the largest reasons that they enter gangs is for that sense of direction. They don't know where to go. They don't know who to follow. So they get insights from who they listen to on the radio. They take the voices of the culture and those around them and anyone who will show and pay attention to them. And one of the largest reasons for gang entry is because of lack of good role models. It doesn't just affect our society, but it also affects even the animal kingdom. In BBC World, they made a mention back in the 70s where this one elephant population was growing too large. So they removed some of the young male elephants out of the area, relocated them in Africa. But what they found was that they started killing and having all these rhino killings. These rhino killings were growing with extreme measure. They weren't sure what to do if they just needed to kill these rhinos. But they said, well, let's bring back into the environment older male rhinos. And within a couple weeks, they found that the killings had stopped, that these young elephants who were going through their version of rut, their aggression subsided. They learned how to actually be elephants and control the instincts that they would have had otherwise that would be highly aggressive. Role models are and examples are so necessary. I think of people in the Christian faith, Jim and Elizabeth Elliot, Johnny Erksentada, D.L. Moody, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, John Bunyan, Jonathan Owens, Edwards, Hudson Taylor, William Craig, Watchman Nee. The list can go on for individuals who have set an example for you personally in your lives. Because they've gone before you. They've showed you the way of what it looks like to back in chapter 2 when Paul says, have this mind in you that was also in Christ, who being in very nature God, did not consider equalness with God as something to be held on to, but emptied himself, taking the nature of a servant, and he submitted and obeyed even to death on a cross. What's this mindset we're to have? A mindset of others oriented, a mindset fixated on Christ, a mindset focused on the Lord with everything within us. Paul's example specifically, do we have that slide if we could put that up? Paul's example, I defined it this way. It's Christ-centered, God-dependent, gospel-focused, scripture-saturated, Holy Spirit-empowered. That will cover, if your heart and your aim is to be a Christian, this is the steps that you can follow and you can be part of and you can need. Paul explains out clearly that because he is Christ-centered, that's who he focuses on. The work of the cross, the message of the cross, the gospel's tied to that. He's focusing on depending on the Lord, relying on his providence, relying on his sovereignty, relying and trusting on the Lord with every step of every breath that he takes. He knows that he knows to know the word of God, spending time with the word, spending time with the Lord, so that he has a message in season and out of season. He needs the power of the Holy Spirit to be able to accomplish a supernatural task like extending God's kingdom. We cannot be Christians without Christ. We cannot be Christians without the power of God living in you and you depending on him, relying on him, trusting him, praying to him, speaking with him so that we know how to live and walk. Chapter 2 makes mention of other examples because not everyone's around Paul. We don't see Jesus face to face. We have the word. But that's why he points out Epaphroditus and Timothy in chapter 2. These were flesh and bone of what it looks like to be Christ-centered and God-dependent and Holy Spirit-empowered and the entire list. Their version of walking that out, not everyone will conform and have the same ministry. Your pulpit might not be on a stage, but in a classroom or a construction site or any number of vocations that God has given us to be able to share and give him glory in. How do we do this? Paul is wanting to encourage people of following his example. That is a command if we go back to that verse. The one right before, just verse 17. Join in following my example. The join in following is a present tense imperative. Basically, ongoing, continuous obedience to continue to follow. You're not sure? Do a character profile of what Paul experienced, what he went through, what he goes through. In 2 Timothy, this is what he says here in 3:10. He says, you know my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, my faith, my patience, my love, my endurance and persecution. You want to see what it means to really follow an example who's a true Christian? He endured some of the harshest trials, whippings and stonings and sleepless nights, and the list goes on. His persecutions was for a cause and a reason, not for his own boasting, but because Jesus is worth it. That only comes when you're Christ-centered, when the very thing you wish to worship is Christ. He deserves your uncomfortable, your uncomfortable circumstances. He deserves your worship despite your circumstances, despite all going on. You should be willing to undergo whatever because Jesus is worth it. He is worth it, church. He says more in 2 Timothy 3:10, my suffering, you know what's happened to me. When he taught, he shared the gospel. But his gospel message was not just coming in word, but it came in deed. His conduct reflected a holy standard that God accepted, that honored him, and that was the whole position that Christians should walk in and follow after as well. So when he says, join and follow my example, and he says, observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. That's another command here when he says to observe those who walk. Pay attention to those who also have the same pattern of godly living. Notice them. Pay attention to them. Imitate them. Be aware that what they're doing, how they're living. Follow after that. Do the same things. Care enough to pick up your phone and call people. Set aside your wants and desires, your pleasures, for the pleasures and the encouragement of others in the faith. You know, this is impossible, the second part of the verse, to observe those who walk according to the pattern if we're not here. If we don't come to church, if we're not involved in body ministry. As much as, and I say this specifically to those watching online, yes, we may get sick, and we have the availability now to be able to be at home. But if our position is always to be home, then really we're disobeying the Lord. We're not growing as well as we can. We're not following after him because we don't have other brothers and sisters to both unite with, encourage us, correct us, teach us things that we can glean from their lives as well as their words. We need to be here and involved in local ministry, involved in body life. It's essential for what God asks of us that we continue to grow into Christ's image. You know, it's not just the example Paul sets, and he points out Timothy, he points out Epaphroditus, because Paul is also speaking, follow me as I follow Christ, that he's speaking through the individual he's talking to. He doesn't just see you and say follow, but if you were to truly follow, that you would also say to the people that you can minister to, your realm of influence, follow me. It's a tall feat. It can be hard. It can sometimes feel discouraging to say, man, Paul, you have a high expectation. I'd rather sit down lower. You know, I have my safety blanket and my comforts and my luxuries. I don't want to self-deny. Christ says, follow me. Pick up your cross, deny yourself, and follow me. His heart and his aim is that we wouldn't just follow godly example, but that we would become the godly example. That we would then share the godly example. And that in turn, the person we share that with would then in turn copy it and do likewise. Because that's the multiplication. That's the value of Christian living. It's not just the things I say. But I can say here, honestly, follow me as I follow Christ. That I want my conduct to be an example and an expression of what it means to be a Christian. I'm not just saying these words, but we need people to come alive to being godly examples. Where is the man who has victory over their flesh? Where's the man that overcomes the common pitfalls and stumbling blocks of the world? Where are the Timothys? Where are the Epaphrodituses? Where are the ones like Timothy where it says that I have no one else like him who has a genuine concern for you? Everyone cares for their own interests, not the interests of Christ. Where are the Timothys? Stand up, church. Be the example. Care for others. Love others. Be willing to risk your life like an Epaphroditus. Be the example to those around you of what it means to follow Jesus because he deserves it. He is the greatest treasure and the greatest worth of my entire life. an example to follow, and an example to be. Godly living, chasing and running after holiness. We have so many in the church, on mainstream television sets, mega pastors left and right, falling left and right by the wayside. Because godly living isn't their highest goal. It might be a source of pride. Yes, we can all stumble. We can. You're not incapable of it. We do scrape our knees off, and we have to aim higher, church. We have to aim at not being okay with the person who says they love Jesus, stands in a pulpit to preach Jesus, and meanwhile is more concerned for the world and how they can derive pleasure from the world than from Jesus. True. An example to follow will be a godly example, the life of godliness, to become godly examples, to share that with others. But my thrust for today, for the next portion, is these next two verses, and it's the example to flee. When we look at verse 18, he says, "For many walk," many, "of whom I've often told you and now tell you, even weeping, crying, with tears," depending on your version, "they are enemies of the cross of Christ." It's many. There are many people. Many. This isn't just the obvious unbeliever whose lifestyle is in complete rebellion to God, who does not submit to God's standard, nor even see a need for the cross. There are those in outright rebellion, yes. But it does say broad is the way that leads to destruction, because it's not just those. And Paul is doing something here. It's easy to identify the unbeliever. They don't pretend with their Christianese that they're Christian. But he says many because he wants to warn them that there are people inside the church. All throughout the New Testament, Acts chapter 20, the second two chapters of 2 Peter, Jude, Revelation, all these books in the New Testament confirm this constant idea that false teachers coming in and being among your midst. People who can say, "I love Jesus," but inwardly they're ravenous wolves. "For many walk, of whom I have often told you and now tell you even weeping." Paul had no problem repeating himself. Because he was sharing truth. We become sometimes so calloused, even with the message of a cross, of atonement, of the precious blood of Jesus, that we hear it and it doesn't even affect us. We don't even cry or weep at our wrongdoing, at his love, at his graciousness, at the things of God that are so wonderful that we can behold them and appreciate them. We can't become callous to truth. We have to allow God to not just have our hearts, our minds, and our emotions. That we should be able to come to a place where we even can be affected and stirred again by the same things over and over. We need these reminders. We need these refreshing times to be encouraged with even the same message. But what does Paul say? He says, "I've told you before, but I'm now telling you even weeping, they're enemies of the cross." Why is he weeping? What are his tears for? Who are they for? Who are these enemies? The tears could be for Christ, because if you look at the scriptures, he says, "even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ. Many walk as enemies, not just of the cross, but of Christ's cross." Paul cares so much for Jesus that anybody who would dishonor him and be adding to the offense towards God, who would reject Jesus, this loathsome, wonderful, humble Savior, it put Paul to tears because he loved the honor and glory of Jesus so much. It also could be, because the scriptures aren't clear, so I'm going to give you ideas. I think they're all of them. When Paul considers that Jesus is being defamed, that Jesus is being mis-explained or mis-seen throughout the church, it brought him to tears. But it was also the believers who were being led astray by these false examples, by these false teachers. He cried that the believers of God were falling victim and being led astray from the true, unadulterated word of God, faithful fellowship with the Lord, and chasing after him and settling for lesser things. And it made Paul cry. He was so concerned with the healthiness of his church that he cried for believers that they wouldn't fall victim to deception. He would also have tears, though, for these enemies. I tell you now, many are enemies of the cross of Christ. In one respect, yes, we love our enemies. We care for them. So much so that it should bring us to tears. Why? Because of who they're against. But the scripture says here in the next verse, it says whose end is destruction. And it's because of where they're going. Paul cared so much for his people. We see it in Romans where he says, I wish that I would even be cut off for the sake of my brethren. Often he says, I've poured and laid my heart out for you, but you're withholding your affections towards me. Paul didn't just love people or share truth. He embodied and lived out with all of his emotions and his desires and his affections towards the people that God had given him to serve and be around. Paul loved deeply. Question is, church, do you love the people around you? The one sitting in the pew, this chair, it's not a pew even, the chair next to you, across the other side. Would you cry if you heard that they were in reproach to Christ? Would you cry if you saw that their lifestyle was in contradiction to the gospel? Would you cry for them, for their state? Paul's mentioning a deep sense of love and concern, and that also is part of the example we should follow. Now it says that, I tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ. We can hint at who these enemies are. And we have a few ideas. I put up a few pictures here. Yes, it could be unbelievers. We mentioned that. But they would be easily identified, at least within the church. But there are these people who have crept in. And they would be defined into two other categories. Antinomians and legalists or Judaizers. These antinomians were Gnostics of that time, who said that because of Christ and the cross and forgiveness, my lifestyle does not matter. Antinomian literally means against law, without law. They will say, the blood of Jesus has covered me, therefore I have a license to sin. It will be forgiven because of Jesus' work. I'm going to do what I want, when I want, how I want. But the real deception here is they're varying degrees. I'm painting a very clear picture, but this comes in shades of gray. Because on one hand, you'll talk to individuals who will uphold the standards of Scripture, but not be conforming to them in their lives. They have the truth, having all of it. But yet in practice, they're hearers of the word and not doers. The other enemy that could be seen of the cross of Christ And the reason antinomians are enemies of the cross, yes, their lifestyle, but part of the cross of what it accomplished in forgiveness of sin, but it was also Jesus showing an example of what it means to honor God and live for God well. And they would be in complete contradiction. And the example that these individuals would set would say, well, what's the big deal if, you know, I said I love Jesus, and that person's going out getting stoned or drunk or having a good time on a Friday night, doing whatever they want, what they please. They don't remember last night. They're boasting or excited about the things they've done. Well, they love Jesus, though. They just got some kinks to work out. It's okay. I can marry my two nephews that are the same sex. It's okay. They love Jesus. It's sometimes easier to see in settings like this, but we take varying degrees where we'll accept cursing, where we'll accept lying, little white lies, little things here and there. But ultimately, as we'll see, why they're enemies of the cross, and it's to find out. The other person in this grouping are legalists, Judaizers, people who, if antinomians wanted to take away from the cross, then the legalists or the Judaizer wanted to add to the cross. These would be individuals who would say, yes, Jesus also. Not grace alone through faith alone. It's not the gift of God alone, but it's also what you do. It's also on top of your justification. It's not just Jesus. They would say, add circumcision. You must be circumcised. You must fast. You must pray this way. You must keep dietary restrictions. You better be following all the ceremonial law. This grouping is easier to see today sometimes because we have other religions. Where even during Ramadan right now, they would fast. And I just read an article from one individual who would say, and some of the points that she mentioned about her fasting and how it helps me to see and experience that I have a choice to be well fed, but there and to appreciate when others don't, and the poverty of some individuals. And that is a very true application. Perspective is wonderful. But to think that she would also be saying that she's penancing or being forgiven of her sins because of her self-denial, that is somehow meriting or earning favor with God, is against what the cross teaches. So these enemies explained help us to come to the next part of Scripture here. They are enemies of the cross. Paul says, whose end is destruction. There's definitely different types of sermons. There's those where you comfort the afflicted or you afflict the comfortable. I don't know what this is. I just know this is the word of God, and I will be unashamed to share all of it. I will not hide from some of the points that are harder to receive or see, because God's word is truth, and it's alive, and it has power, and it's able to transform us. Says that these enemies of the cross, their end is destruction. The word used for destruction is not annihilation. It is not existence. It's if you get in a car accident, that car being completely destroyed would mean that it would be ruined. It would be complete failure. That's the picture. That's the idea. Their end is ruin. Their end is failure. Because it's very rare, I listen to many sermons, and the concept and the conversation about hell is so little talked about, I would like to give a brief, small doctrine about it. If we have the next slide here. Basic points of what hell is. is that it is eternal. Just as we say they will be given eternal life, people wish to twist the scriptures to say, well, it can't mean eternal hell or eternal death. That's not okay. But if we're to be consistent, we as biblical Christians believe in an eternal afterlife of life or an eternal afterlife of death. This place is never ending, never stopping. It's conscious. The individual will not be in this location forever without realizing with what's happening. They will. It is a place specific of punishment and torment. This isn't a discipline action. This is a sentencing. This is a place that the last one says it's inescapable. An inescapable place of punishment and torment that you are alive and experiencing forever and ever and ever. If I were to summarize other passages from Scripture about this, the Bible is very careful and clear to let us know about the final destination of the lost. It's terrible beyond imagination. It will involve tribulation, which means great trouble or suffering, anguish, weeping, gnashing of teeth. It's called a furnace of fire, causing eternal loss and everlasting destruction. Its fires will be unquenchable, and the smoke of their torment will go up forever and ever. And so they will have no rest. So rare to hear this, that it hurts, it's uncomfortable. I had so much melancholy and tears and crying all week. The Word of God, and it's true. And we as Christians have so run away from it because we're offended by it. We're offended by the reality of it. We're offended that people would go there. Because at the root of it, in the Christian gospel, in the American Christian gospel, what we're seeing is a false God being presented. We have half of the pendulum. Everybody knows the verse that God is love, and that is one of his attributes, yes. But God of the Bible is also just. He is also holy. Holy, holier, holiest to the superlative level, meaning that whatever degree you think of God, he is greater and loftier and more infinite and more powerful and more perfect. This is the God of the Bible. And so people reason and they say, how could a loving God send someone to an eternal, everlasting place of torment that they could never escape? That's not love. But you forget those other attributes. It's like this. If I were to go into a junkyard and I took a key and I'm starting to scratch up a bunch of car doors in that junkyard, someone might say, quit it. If I were to go into a used car lot and start keying some cars, you better believe I'm going to get a fine. If I go onto a Ferrari lot and I'm starting to key up some cars, as a matter of fact, I wouldn't even get close enough to the car, most likely, before someone saying, what are you doing? But if I were to key that car, I would spend time most likely in jail. Because the consequence was also determined by the offense that you did and the value of the offense that was occurred. So what do you really think? Eternity is absolutely the case when you've offended and keyed a holy, perfect, limitless God. David Platt says, hell is the reality that our sins against the infinite holy God warrant an infinitely eternal punishment. The doctrine of hell is uncomfortable. The reality of it is something we may want to run from or not accept or ever talk about, but is nonetheless true. And as a matter of fact, when we don't share it or we will never talk about it, we just do disservice to God because it magnifies the fullness picture of the cross. See, the second part of David Platt's quote here, it says, when we minimize the reality of hell, we malign the mercy of God. Because central to the fact of hell is that before you're there, it is escapable. Jesus endured the wrath of God on our behalf so that we can be delivered from his wrath and the punishment that we deserve and be brought into fellowship with him forever. The fact of hell is so true and ugly, and it's made me cry so often, but it also makes me see the gift, the joy, the wonderful good news properly. That for God's justice to be served, that he could even forgive a sinner, that God himself would have to die. That he sent his son to take the wrath of God, to take your place, that you can be forgiven. All of God's attributes are on display on that cross. His justice, his mercy, his love, his holiness. We only talk about a couple, but it's not true and not fair. And we might be leading people astray to not see the full picture. Paul defines the enemies and says where their end is. And the example we need to flee, we see their destiny, and we're going to also mention their deity, their disgrace, and their drive. He goes on to say, enemies of the cross of Christ end is destruction. Their God is their appetite. Their God is their appetite. Another version would say their God is their belly. You could take it literally. Some individuals, gluttony is a real thing. And their God is every impulse to have food satisfy all of their aches and pains. But the appetites, the arousals of our flesh, it includes a lot more than just that. Self-indulgence as a whole is on display here. Their end, destruction. Their deity, this is the example of someone who says, I love Jesus. Even the demons can say they know God. People in church, people here today, we can say we know Jesus. And yet our God is really our selfish impulses, self-indulgence, self-exaltation. What that looks like for the antinomian is easier to see. It's easy to see when someone says they love God, they love Christ, and disobey his laws flagrantly by going and doing horrific sexual immoral things. If they're going out drunkenness, the list is easier to see in that respect. But the God of their belly for the legalist, who also says they love Jesus, it's a bit harder. What are their appetites? Their appetites are seen and being noticed. Did you see what I did? They love being on the street corners. They love being able to pray in front of people. They love being noticed. They had greed in their heart. It's harder to see them. But nonetheless, their God is still self. We need to flee this example. Flee it. Run from it, church. Run as fast as you can. Don't imitate them. Look to those in the church at Tri-County Worship Center whose lifestyle is reflecting the very God they're preaching. Don't settle for mediocrity. Don't have a Laodicean spirit. Don't be lukewarm. Their God is their appetite. Their glory is in their shame. What they're boasting in and excited about is the very thing they should be ashamed of. Two things happened. The cross took away one aspect of shame. He covered our shame and our guilt in the sight of a holy God. But the shame that our society is also trying to wipe out and say you should never have is that when you flagrantly disobey the Lord, that you should somehow not have any shame about it. That is not true and not biblical. There is a true sense of shame that will bring us to a place where we will fall to our knees and cry out for repentance and ask God to forgive me and aim harder at not doing it again. Their glory is in their shame. They're so excited, these legalists that are in our church and filling sometimes many churches. They're so excited and they're praising God, but their shame and their glory and what they're excited about is themselves. And so they're glad to put on display, man, I just went to Africa. Did you hear what I said? I just went to Africa on a mission trip. I didn't get paid for 3 weeks. Can you believe I did that? I drilled 4 wells. 4. You know how much of my money and my time I spent on that? Wow, you're awesome. Wow, you're amazing. How many people did you save? It's less about the glory of God. And it's more about the glory of self. We do those things. We go on trips. We dig wells. We drill. We save. We share the gospel. But we do it for His glory and His credit, for the glory of God for our lives, because He is so deserving. The last part there says, who set their minds on earthly things. Who set their minds on earthly things. This mindset on, set, focused, but it's almost as if they were to shift anywhere else, that their mind's being pulled back to the natural. There are many, many individuals who cannot escape the focus, the thought pattern of what I'm going to do after I leave church. They're more concerned about how I'm going to be pleased when I leave here, what food I will eat, what fun I will have. And it has nothing to do with eternal, everlasting, and spiritual things ever. The mind is set on. It's focused. It's instilled in them. The love of the world. To gather more toys, to acquire more things, to make more money. I can't go to church. I can't go there. That's too much of a sacrifice. I get paid more to do it this way. I'll find accommodations in every way I can so that what's most important to me stays most important. This world, the natural, set on earthly things. To read a verse here of Revelation. There, Revelation 21, verse 8. Says, read from verse 5. It says, "He who was seated on the throne said, 'I'm making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all of this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magical arts, the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death." Sometimes easy to start categorizing that list. We rank the top ones. We see the vile and the murderers, the immortal, the adulterers, the people who practice magical arts, and we say, okay, I get it. Second to that, but a little bit less, we say lies, liars, unbelievers. Okay, I guess, you know, I understand. But the first one on this list is sometimes the most troubling, where he says the cowardly. These are people who are so ashamed of Christ that given opportunities to share him, they deny him. They don't speak up. They live lifestyles of constant, unwilling glory that Christ rightfully deserves, because at the root of it, the God of the belly says that'll make you uncomfortable. They might not like you. And self-preservation is at the root of a cowardly heart, of unwilling to feel and to press in and to have faith and trust the Lord. But let me say this too, though. We all can fit into that category of cowardly. We miss opportunities. We make mistakes. Peter himself denied Christ 3 times. But you know what? God is not talking the cowardly on one instance. This is a lifestyle of constant cowardly attitudes. I just want to say this, church, in closing. Sometimes words don't do justice. I'd rather just read the Word of God itself. In Hebrews 10, verse 26, it says, "If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sin is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejects the law of Moses died without mercy at the testimony of 2 or 3 witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, 'It is mine to avenge, I will repay.' And again, 'The Lord will judge his people.' It's a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." God's word's clear. It's not shaded gray. It's not confusing. The point is this. Does this define you? You're playing church? You're playing Russian roulette? Paul cares too much for the people of God. That's why he says you need to follow genuine examples so that the counterfeit is seen. But his message is none less clear for those counterfeit. There is hope. You can leave your position and run into the arms of the only one who can save you. Some of you today need to get right. Some of you have never even made a commitment for Christ ever. Truly depending and relying on Him and trusting what He's done in place and for you. That offer is available. Take it while it's here, church. Ask for forgiveness. Cry and wail and mourn and sit there like the publican in the front on your knees, pounding your chest, asking for the mercy of God. He will give it. Arms are open. We're not going to play games or be able to talk our way out of it on that day. God makes a way for all of us to be forgiven. All can come and know the truth of salvation, this wonderful gift. We're going to sing a song and close with the team come up. You got to get right. You got to get right. You've accepted Christ, but you are so far from what He expects of you, and the inner confession of the Holy Spirit has been convicting you for so long, and you've been under that weight. But Paul is trying to say where your end is going to be. What's going to actually happen to you? You're living as an actual enemy. Cry out to Christ. There is no other name given under heaven and earth by which we must be saved. But you can be saved. You can be forgiven. Today's a day to squirm, to flinch, to be uncomfortable, but to get right, to see the fear of God. I don't want to emotionally pull you in a place where it feels so negative, but sometimes the things that are sober are so hard to are so unpalatable. They're like the big horse pill. We want to soften it, and I refused to do that today because I wanted God's word to speak to your hearts. That the church would aim at following godly example. Live holy lives and be that example. Would so care about the lost and those who will experience this place that you will share the love of God. That you won't sit and keep it to yourself. Because you know where they're going. When was the last time you broke for those unbelieving? When was the last time your heart cried for the end who will experience eternal fire? Does it bother you? You have a role to play. Be on fire for Him. Love Him. Serve Him. Give your all. We're going to sing this song together. You know what you need to do. You need to talk to somebody. You need to repent. You need to confess. You need to be on your hands and feet. You do that. You come.
Still I will follow.
Church. Christ is so wonderful, so amazing. You look to the cross, may it touch you afresh with emotion of every quality and attribute of God being displayed. To follow the examples of the godly, would you be that godly example? Would you intercede and pray for and grow in the boldness God wants to give to share to a hurt, dying, and lost world. This is our commission, church. This is our aim. This is our focus. This is our God. Let's do this. We'll leave triumphant because we know we're promised eternity with Him. But while we're here, can you say it with me? I'm going to be about my Father's business. Amen. God bless you all. Have a wonderful day.
Thing I've ever done.